Hey everyone, I'm back with another video, and in this one I want to show all the Muslims that have watched my videos that I really am an ex-Muslim, and I also want to demonstrate to all of you Christians who watch this what it's like to grow up with Islam and what you usually are taught at an early age. So let's get right to it. I'm going to start off with when I was 3 years old. When I was three, I practically taught myself how to play an instrument and sing. I was a self-taught musician in that way. And how I would sing a song and play it on the instrument, which for me was the piano, was that I would listen to a song. And then the way it sounded was the way I would play it. And also songs that I had memorized from school, from kindergarten and all of that, I would remember and then I would be able to play it. So every song that I learned at kindergarten, which tended to be Western songs, but not only Western, but also Christian songs, or songs that were related to Christmas. So there was a lot of Christian influence in the songs that I learned at that age. So at the very beginning of my life, my very first impression and the kind of music that I preferred was really Western and Christian songs. So this quickly became a passion, a hobby. This is something I did every single day, practically the rest of my life. And I still am to this day. To this day, I am a singer and I still play the piano. And throughout my entire life, as I have grown older and I have gotten more accustomed to, you know, Western music and such things, I have learned a lot of Christian songs or Christianity-influenced songs, and these songs have, in many ways, strengthened my faith in God. Not necessarily brought me closer to Allah, but it has brought me closer to God and wanting to seek the truth and gain some clarity in my life. And I would have to say that the most influential times in my life when this was very, very intense was, you know, from when I was 3 years old up to I was 10 years old, I think. That's when I, you know, first learned everything. But then around 10 years of age, I also started to, I joined a choir. I joined a choir school, so to speak. It was something where you would, besides attending school, you would also attend this choir every single day, and we would go together on different, you know, trips around different countries, and most of our concerts, which was during that period that I was part of the choir, which was 6 years, most of the time we sang in churches. So we went to practically every church in our town and in our country, and also went to different churches abroad. So I was already growing up from when I first learned to sing and play the piano up until, you know, before I started high school, I was always exposed to people from different religions, most of them Christians or atheists who would challenge my faith. But also I was part of this choir that was always exposed to a Christian environment. So I always knew a little bit more about Christianity than my fellow Muslims. I always had a better, more open-minded opinion about other religions beside Islam. Now, another very important aspect of my life was Christmas. Already when I was three and up, pretty much, my family introduced Christmas traditions in our household. We didn't celebrate Christmas as it was celebrated. We put our own little twist to it. So instead of celebrating Jesus' birth on the 24th or 25th of December, which is usually the date that people celebrate Christmas around the world, we would put up the Christmas tree 1st of December, and we would buy different gifts for one another and put those gifts under the Christmas tree, and then we would wait until New Year's, because on New Year's Eve or the New Year's morning, New Year's Day, we would open these gifts. And so we turned pretty much Christmas into our own little version where we fused it with New Year's, and we would just call it the New Year celebration. And this is something we continued every single year until we were pretty much, you know, as old as we are today. However, something that's I really need to highlight here is that Christmas celebrations or any other celebration that's not of Islam is not allowed in Islam. You're not to participate in something that is not Muslim, according to the Quran and according to the Hadiths. And I have a few verses here for you guys who are dying to see me quote things. This is from chapter 5, verse 51 in the Quran, and it says, O ye who believe, take not the Jews and the Christians for your friends and protectors. They are but friends and protectors to each other. And he amongst you that turns to them for friendship is of them. Verily, Allah guideth not a people unjust. Then there's another verse, but from 5:3 in the Quran, and it says, This day I have perfected your religion for you, completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you Islam as your religion. According to Sahih Bukhari, 1397 is the number, and Sahih Muslim, 4822, the Prophet said, You will certainly follow the ways of those who came before you, handspan by handspan, cubit by cubit, to the extent that if they entered the hole of a lizard, you will enter it too. We said, O Messenger of Allah, do you mean the Jews and the Christians? He said, Who else? According to Al-Bukhari 4:25 and Muslim 5:31, it says, May the curse of Allah be upon the Jews and the Christians, for they took the graves of their prophets as places of worship. I'll continue. And he told us that when a righteous man among them died, they would build a place of worship over his grave and install images therein, and that they were the most evil of mankind. This second part is from Al-Bukhari 4:17 and Muslim 5:28. Why I'm saying these verses is to really highlight or, you know, emphasize on that this twist that we put on Christmas when I was so young. There was a reason for it, and that was that although most Muslims wouldn't even agree on putting a twist to it according to these verses, but because we were moderate, modern integrated Muslims into the West, my parents put this twist because according to these verses, it is pretty much haram or forbidden to imitate non-believers or kafir. And the ones who do is a kafir. That is really the message that you learn here. Well, that is really just a few of the verses. So it's been made very clear not to participate in these things, not to do what Christians or Jews are doing, but to do specifically what Islam says. Especially this thing that God said that he has chosen for you Islam as your religion. He's really making it clear, these boundaries, that, you know, Islam is the only thing you should be occupying yourself with. Do not pay attention to these other faiths and what they're doing. I'll continue. At the age of 4, I learned to read and write. This was very unusual for people my age. But, you know, I was a bit of a special case. The doctor we had visited had told, you know, usually they do these procedures with kids to see, you know, they test their intelligence or their motoric skills and such things. And they did that with me, and they said, you know, this girl, she is a little bit ahead of her age in her intelligence. So, you know, you should stimulate her, you know, you should give her more things, give her instruments and whatnot, so she can really use this and maximize her potential. So at the age of 4, I asked my parents, can I learn to read and write? And my aunt, pretty much, she taught me, and everybody else around me, they were there and they taught me how to read and write. And what came along with this reading and writing so early was that I started very soon to, you know, analyze and reflect. I've been told that when I was around the age of 4, just when I had learned to read and write, I would read newspapers to my aunt. And she would say, she would tell me what these things meant that I read, because I was so curious about it. And I have apparently read a part in the newspaper that talked about rape. And apparently I had told my aunt, or asked her, what does rape mean? I wanted to know what that meant, and she couldn't answer. So she was very, you know, taken by this. People were really bothered by, or disturbed by, just how far ahead I was from my age. And this, you know, in Islam, this could be a problem. And we know why, because to understand that Islam is a lie, you would have to reflect, analyze, and question. To solve this, I guess, or, well, you know, whether they thought of it as bad or good, they actually gave me a journal, a diary, at the age of 7, so I could start pouring all my thoughts and such things into them. I don't know if they were monitored or not, I have no idea, but that's what I did. Moving on, at the age of 5, I, for the first time, got really heavily involved in Islam. That is, my mom and my dad started learning or teaching me and my brothers a lot about Islam. They probably knew about it before me, but, you know, because they were older. But that's when I learned it. And I learned the practical aspects of it, the how to practice Islam. I learned how to do the prayer. I learned what was haram, what was halal. I learned about the judgment day. I learned about the basic principles that there's no God, other than Allah. That Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was his messenger, and all of these things. And I want to talk specifically about the prayer. This is very, very important here. Because when I learned the prayer, at first, what happened was that I observed my mom doing the prayer. She would show me or demonstrate me as she did her prayer, and I would watch her and I would imitate her. And this encouraged her to, you know, further teach me about the principles of Islam and prayer. And I do recall having sat in her room and how she would teach me, you know, about the importance of prayer, what it did for you, how it was the main communication to your God, and that was, although you could speak to God, the prayer was sort of the means of being in direct contact with Him. It was like having a rope tied between you and God, and when you didn't do your prayer, that rope was cut off, and God wouldn't remember you, He wouldn't recognize you. So the principle was that the more that you remembered God and glorified and praised Him in prayer, in Salat, which was a specific kind of prayer you did 5 times a day, the more God would remember you, the more He would love you and accept you into His heart and into paradise, you know? That was the principle. And I was, at that age, you know, besides having been so active, having such a high activity in my brain and all that, and that I was reading a lot of children's books. I recall I even finished every single book in the library. That was how, you know, I was really hungry for information. Besides that, I was also going through a lot of problems in school. I was being bullied because I was so kind and well-mannered. And I was really one of those kids that hated to fight. I hated to get in any kind of brawl. Fighting scared me, and I really loved everyone. I was just a very innocent kid. Very quiet, very silent one. And quite introverted. So I needed something to lean on. I needed this support net with God. I believed in Him when I was taught about Him. And I needed to know that He would be there for me and support me and all that. So my mom taught me that basically you get that kind of love and support from God through prayer. And some of you might want some sources on this, and I can tell you that there are multiple. I have some here for you. The importance of prayer, you can find, for instance, in the Quran in verse 238, which says, "Maintain with care the obligatory prayers, and in particular the middle prayer, and stand before Allah, devoutly obedient." Verse 245, "And seek help through patience and prayer, and indeed it is difficult except for the humbly submissive to Allah." Verse 558, "And when you call to prayer, they take it in ridicule and amusement. That is because they are people who do not use reason." So according to God, people who do not pray, people who ridicule the prayer or the call to prayer, they do not reason. This is another way of saying that if you do not understand the importance of doing the salat, you are not a person who reasons. There is also multiple other verses about the importance of prayer in the Quran. I can give you some here. 4:103, 17:78, 2:43, 73:6, 29:45, 4:101, 9:103, 22:26, 22:35, 41:51, 11:114. Go ahead, look it up. It is very important. It's part of the very core essential idea of being a Muslim is to do the Salat. It is one of the core pillars of Islam. It's very hard to get to God, to have some kind of relationship with God, unless you do this ritualistic prayer. It's very important. If you want an idea of how complicated and intricate this thing is, especially for women, and how the female prayer is different from the male's prayer, you can look it up on YouTube. There is a very good video for it. I just looked it up, and I agree with what she was doing. It is sort of what we were taught, if you want to do it correctly. And it is called Women's Prayer According to Quran and Sunnah. Google that. I'll post the link below in the description box or the comment section. So I thought I could demonstrate to you guys a little bit about how I was taught to do my prayer. Now you need to understand that there is some variety allowed in different sections of the prayer. For instance, the end of the prayer, you are allowed to sort of pick and choose what verse or what thing you want to say. Some people say something from the Quran, but a lot of people, they pick something from where they sort of glorify Muhammad and you know, the prophet. And so there is some there are varieties of how to do this, but there is a basic principle, and I want to show you guys the basic principle as broad as I can and sort of demonstrate the verses that I remember from my prayer. And what I did was that I used the same system throughout my whole life. It was only recently, sometime 2012 to 2013, that I started getting involved into a more accurate method of praying according to the hadiths and sunnahs and such. But then I became a Quranist, and then everything sort of fell apart. But that's for another day. So let me demonstrate. First and foremost, I'm going to do this as quick as I can. You begin the prayer by lifting your hands up, your palms. Some people put them here, I don't know. I did it here. And you do the niyat. Niyat is your declaration of your intention, the intention of the prayer, pretty much. Which prayer are you doing? How many sessions of that prayer are you going to do? Because it's divided up in sessions. And also that you make it clear that you're doing this to worship your Lord, Allah. So you do that, you do the niyat, and then you you rebuke the devil, which in according to Islam, you say, A'udhu billahi min al-shaytan al-rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And then, so you know, some people also say other verses related to that, or before or after that, but that's what I did. And then you begin the prayer. You lift down the hands, and you put them on your hands on your bosom, if you are a woman. And then you begin. And I said the Al-Fatiha, which is the very first surah of the Quran. I said that one. I did it at the beginning of every single session. It sounded like this. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawm al-deen. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'een. Ihdina s-sirat al-mustaqeen. Sirat al-ladheena an'amta alayhim. Ghayr al-maghdubi wa alayhim. Wa al-dhaaleen. Ameen. You really have to pull those two out. And while I was doing this, I was looking down on the carpet at the end of it. Keeping my eyes fixed at the end of the carpet, prayer carpet. And then I would continue. I would say, قُلْ اللَّهُ أَحَدَ اللَّهُ وَالْسَمَدِ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولِدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. And then I would do the Allahu Akbar, and then I would put my hands on my knees, and I would bend over. So there would be a 90-degree angle. I'd bend over, stand, and I would say, SubhanAllah, 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 probably من حمدة, or if I said ربنا ولك الحمد, it was one of them. But then I would go down after that, saying Allahu Akbar, or not, I don't remember. I would go down and I would put my hands next to my ears and put my feet, my legs closed up, and, you know, basically hunching or whatever you call it. I was sitting on my knees and with my hands like this. And I would say, Subhanallah bil'ala, Subhanallah bil'ala, Subhanallah bil'ala. Go up, Allahu Akbar, go down, Subhanallah bil'ala, Subhanallah bil'ala, Subhanallah bil'ala, Allahu Akbar. And then you got up and then you put your hand on your chest again. That was one round, aka one section, or a session, I mean. That was one session of a prayer. And the morning prayer had two sessions. The noon prayer had four. The afternoon prayer had four. The late afternoon prayer had three. And then the evening prayer had four. So it was Fajr, Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. Five prayers a day. You have to do them at the exact time that they have been decided for the region where you live. Every region in every country has its own time. That was one session. The second session looked very similar. You just changed. After the Al-Fatiha, you said a shorter verse from the Quran, and that one used to be for me, إِنَّ أَعْتَيْنَكَ الْكَلْثَرَ فَصَلِّ رَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِيَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. And after the second session, you wouldn't stand up, but you would remain seated. And you would do the seated verse, which was إِلْتَحِيَاتُ لِلَّهِ وَالصَّلَوَاتُ وَالطَّيْبَاتُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكَ أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْنَا وَعَلَى عِبَادُ اللَّهِ الصَّالِحِينَ. And then you would say أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. But when you said that, you would just sit down looking at the carpet, the same place, nothing special, nothing additional, is what I did. And then I got up. And then you start all over again with the first session. And then you do the second session, the same way that I mentioned. The only difference is that on the fourth run, when you sit down, you have to, at the end of the shahada, at the end of the ishad, which is the declaration of faith, where you say, there is no God other than God, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his prophet. When you say that, you have to lift, for some reason, I don't know to this day why, but you have to lift your right finger, this one, when you, usually both of your hands are placed on your knee like this, but then you lift this finger up, pointing towards Mecca. I don't know why, but that's what you do. And then when you've done that, you continue with a final verse, which is, for me, I use this one. I said, I think it was to glorify Muhammad. It was Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Sayyidina Muhammad kama thalika ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa baraka ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Sayyidina Muhammad kama thalika ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala Sayyidina Ibrahim fil alameen innaka hamidun majid. And then I would do the assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As you move your face to the right, you greet the angel to the right, because in Islam you've been taught that you have two angels, one on the right side, one on the left side, that records every single action that you do, the good and the bad. And one of these angels are, you look at the end of the prayer. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Wa assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, you say to the other one. Some people also say that you simply just greet your Muslim, your fellow Muslim on either end, on either side of you, when you do the congregational prayer. I don't know the detail of this. I could look it up later. But that is what it looks like. At the end of the prayer, that's when you can do the dua. Dua is when you pray for other people's well-being, for yourself. You pray, for instance, you know, God, grant me good health, help me succeed, show me the path in which you want me to walk on to be successful. You say all these things. And you, at the same time, you glorify God, you praise God, you pray for the prophet, for his wife, for the different prophets you've been taught about, for your loved ones who have deceased, or, you know, passed away. And that's sort of what you do. And some Muslims, they go further. Because you've been taught, according to hadiths, that there is, I think so, at least that's where I got it from, where else did I get it, that you would have these pearls, this pearl necklace, which a lot of people actually purchase from Mecca when they go and do the pilgrimage. You would have this pearl necklace and you would sort of swipe them, and they were an exact number. I think it was 33. I don't remember, but it was an exact number of pearls, and at every pearl you would say three times in total. It would be, for every pearl you would say, you would glorify God, you would praise him for his, you know, how incredible he is, and what was it? It was subhanallah, la ilaha illallah, and there was another one, I don't remember which one it was. But you did these three things where you sort of worship your Lord three times per pearl until you reach the end of the pearl, and that's when you say something longer. I never did this properly. It was never something that neither me or my siblings did. This was mostly my mom. She was the most dedicated Muslim in our household. She did everything according to the book, as well as she could, because my mom, she didn't... Like most Muslims, she was educated on Islam from her relatives, from her parents. So it was only until later ages, later years, where she learned about the very details in the hadiths. This was in relation to when she started to wear a hijab, the veil, which she began wearing after her mother passed away, and she got very close to a lot of extremely devoted Muslims who convinced her to cover her hair. Shortly after that, she also traveled to the holy city, according to Islam, of Mecca, and did the pilgrimage with my dad. After that, they became, you know, more holy in other people's eyes and in God's eyes. And so my mom, at later ages, same with my dad, later age, they became more devoted to the scriptures and more, they did it more accurately. But prior to that, they were always Muslims. My mom started doing a prayer at the age of 18, and she never ever, her whole life, cut off the prayer. She always did it by, according to the times, her whole life. My dad, his dad was an imam. He was a famous imam of the village that he was from. This imam was known to always sit in his room and read the hadiths, the Qurans. He was a very knowledgeable man in his field. He was a wise guy of the village. People would come to him for advice. This was my dad's dad, and he encouraged my dad to become an imam. But my dad didn't want to. He wanted to become a highly academic person, whatever you call it. He wanted to study for something very, very high in science, which he did. I'm not going to talk about their history. The point is that the Muslim influence, it runs in our family. You know, they both came from a Muslim household. They were both very, very devoted Muslims. They never sinned in any great ways according to Islam. They didn't drink any alcohol. They didn't eat any pork. They didn't party or anything like that. They were very devoted, humble, according to Islam, modest and devoted Muslims. So it was just natural for them to raise us according to Islam. And because I was so innocent and all of that, and such a just gullible child, they kind of used that to convey Islam's message on me at an early age. Same with my brothers. So we were all a very devoted Muslim family. None of us had any, you know, we didn't do drugs, we didn't even smoke, we didn't have any alcohol ever, you know, we were no pork, nothing like that. We were very, very, you know, although we didn't do things perfectly by the scripture, we did the major principles of Islam, the main things you're supposed to do for the pillars. I kind of lost my trail there, what I was going to say. So, yes, I was demonstrating the prayer. That is what it's like. The prayer is very, very... it's very detailed, ritualistic. And I did it this way. I did it this way, and it was approved by my mom and by everybody else. They said, oh, you know, it's fair enough. It's good enough for now, but you have to study it more. You have to do more hadith and Quran readings to further improve your prayer. But this is how I did it. And I still, you know, all the way up to my late, what's it called? My mid-20s. I did this whole way. And this is how my siblings prayed, and this is how, well, my mother did better, but this is sort of how she prayed. And my dad. Everybody in my household prayed at least some point in their life. We all had this issue where we prayed sometimes we didn't pray. So it was a lot of this on and off thing. Reason being, because we were all very, very spiritually confused. We didn't feel that there was any salvation to be found in Islam. We didn't feel saved. We didn't feel that it was any spiritual gain. We just, somehow we had been convinced that everything was going to be fine for us. But we were always afraid, for some reason, of death. We were afraid to end up in hell in any way, any case. So, you know, for me, at least, it was a ritualistic thing. And it's something I felt I had to do to be deemed good enough to Allah. And, you know, at that age as well, besides being so young and everything else that I've described that mattered, they also, you know, it was made very clear that there was really no other option besides Islam. And, you know, we were very early taught that, you know, Jesus wasn't crucified, that there was only one God, there was no Trinity concept. We were taught that, you know, we were very different from the way Christians and Jews did things, and that the ways we did things were correct. So already then, it left no room in our lives for seeing other options. Because anyone who's read the Quran, just the very second chapter, Al-Baqarah, it's called, the second chapter, if you read it, you see that there's a lot of fear, guilt, and shame thrown in there towards disbelievers. So you immediately get afraid. When you start off that young, get afraid. afraid of ending up in hell, afraid of God's punishment. You become terrified to ever be one of the unbelievers. So it's not, you know, add one plus one together. It's not so, you know, difficult to realize why Muslims are Muslims. When it starts when they're so young and you are so heavily indoctrinated and sort of, well, practically forced to learn these things that I learned, and you don't really have another option. If you want any sources about this, I can choose some from the Quran that really shows this. Verse 931, it says, "They, Jews and Christians, took their rabbis and their monks to be their lords besides Allah, by obeying them in things which they made lawful or unlawful according to their own desires, without being ordered by Allah. And they also took as their Lord Messiah, son of Maryam, Mary, while they, Jews and Christians, were commanded in the Taurat, or Torah, and the Injil, which means the Gospel, to worship none but one God, Allah. La ilaha illallah. None has the right to be worshipped but He. Praise and glory be to Him. Far above is He from having the partners they associate with Him." I mean, already there you realize there is a huge difference between how Jews and Christians are taught about God and how Allah is taught about God. So there needs to be this separation. At least when you have gone a little bit further into your Quran, because everybody knows who've done these studies, at the very beginning, you know, that's not what it looks like. Rather, Muhammad tries to make Christians and Jews think that we're all sort of the same religion, that Islam sort of brings everyone together and is the improved version of Christianity and Judaism. Verse 25:52 says, "So do not obey the disbelievers and strive against them with the Quran, a great striving." Verse 3:100, "O you who believe, if you obey a group of those who are given the scripture, Jews and Christians, they would indeed render you disbelievers after you have believed." Verse 4:159, "And there is none of the people of the scripture, Jews and Christians, but must believe in him, Jesus, son of Mary, as only a messenger of Allah and a human being before his Jews or Christians, death, at the time of the appearance of the angel of death. And on the day of resurrection, he, Jesus, will be a witness against them." This is insane when I read it now, after what I know. Verse 932, "They, the disbelievers, the Jews and the Christians, want to extinguish Allah's light with which Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, has been sent, Islamic monotheism, with their mouths, but Allah will not allow except that his light should be perfected, even though the kafirun, the disbelievers, hate it." So it's being made pretty clear here that we are to separate between us and them. I'm thinking from the mindset of when I was a Muslim, of course. So on top of all of that, of not having been given much of an option, I was also very soon in my life, when I was around 5, frightened into believing in jinns. There was these spiritual beings in another dimension, another world, that watched me, that were always with me. And I believed it. I believed it heavily. And I believed in the judgment day. They would talk about that the judgment day would happen any moment. So when I was a kid, I would lie awake and I would look out the window at night and I would wonder, I wonder if the judgment day is going to happen now. Maybe it's going to happen 2 minutes from now, maybe 3 minutes from now. So I was at that age terrified of Islam, while at the same time, the fear brought me into belief. This is something that carried me through my entire life. Every time I felt an intense fear of Islam, of the punishment of God, that's when I would be motivated to do the prayers, for instance. I'll talk about that in other videos. So to draw a conclusion here, I feel like my motivation behind becoming a Muslim was really that there wasn't any other option. And that there was a lot of fear and guilt and shame that awaited me had I not believed. And as a child, I needed love and I needed acceptance from my parents like any other child. Children want to be, they want to feel like they're part of the group. They want to feel like they get the reassurance or the acceptance pretty much from their parents. They don't want to feel like any black sheep. They don't want to be an outsider. And above all, they believe their parents, they feel that, you know, any parent who's watching this knows that their children adore them and almost view them as an encyclopedia, sort of. They look at you as if you are a fact book. Everything that comes out of your mouth, they think is the truth. They think it's facts. They tend to have, you know, all these discussions at that age with their little, you know, friends, and the basis of that discussion tends to be that, you know, my mom knows better than your mom and your mom knows better than me. It's always like that, because that is as far as we go in terms of intelligence and understanding. And this is what Islam does. Now, you could argue that a lot of other religions and ideologies do the same to their kids when they're that young. But with Islam, you have to understand that if you, you know, one of the things you have to understand at least is that there is a lot of playing on your emotional health. So sort of, there's a manipulation of your emotions and your psyche. A lot of Muslims tend to bring you to Islam by using your emotions against you, using your current state against you. If you're going through grief, they kind of bring that and use that as a weapon to bring you to Islam. That's what happened to my mom with her hijab. That's what happened to me when I was going through a lot of crisis and I was sort of brought to Islam repeatedly because I was terrified. That's what it does. If you're a child, you don't know much, you don't understand much, they play on that, they use that to bring you to Islam, because they don't care about how they do it, they don't care about if it's whether it's abusive or not. You know, sure, it might be a mild version of abuse, but they don't care. They care about whether or not you are a Muslim, because if you don't die a Muslim, you're going to hell. You know, because of the very clear distinction between Muslims and Christians and Jews in the Quran. I can find other sources for that another time. The point is, there's a severe punishment if you are to be of something else but a Muslim. And this is not something any parent who is a Muslim want for their children. They want their children to go to heaven. So they really believe that this is the real God. They believe that this is the true path to paradise, to heaven. So they do everything in their power to keep their children in Islam through guilt, through shame, through fear. And of course, manipulating your current state, turning that into a weapon to bring you to Islam. Besides mentioning all of this of Islam, I want to bring something positive into this equation. I want to talk very briefly about that. When I was around 7 or so, I had my very first public performance, musical performance in school. And the song that I chose was actually a song inspired by Judeo-Christian beliefs. It was about, it was called When You Believe by Whitney Houston and Mariah Carey. This was my favorite song, and it was not Muslim, and it was definitely influenced by Christianity and Judaism. The whole story of Moses was very, very important for me at that age. For some reason, I loved the movie about Moses. I really loved the aspects of Christianity and Judaism, and I had no idea why or how or... But these things were important for me. When I was 4, maybe 3, and my mom had this thesis she had to write. Part of her thesis was to interview her children to see what they thought God looks like. So we had to paint God. My brothers painted all kinds of things, like the sun and the clouds and things like that. I was the only one who painted a man with a white dress or robe and a big cross at the front of it. And it was pretty evident that in my head, God was Jesus. So I had these influences of Christianity and Judaism from an early age. And, you know, some people can argue that you were younger, you know, you came to this country when you were younger than your siblings, maybe you had more of an influence from the Western culture, but they were equally exposed to it as I was. And, you know, it was more of that it intrigued me and that I felt that I leaned more towards that. I could identify more towards those values, towards those things, than to all this fear around Islam. Another thing I want to talk about that's actually very positive is that I actually forgot what that was. I guess I'll just save that for another video. I mean, we've already reached 45 minutes. Guys, I think this is enough for now. This is the very, you know, this is one part of my life, the beginning, and this is how Islam and Christianity had a role in it. And I just wanted to mention it, and having mentioned it, also hopefully convinced you guys that I am really an ex-Muslim. I know what I'm talking about, and if you still don't believe, I do not know what else to do. I'll just leave it at that. Thank you guys for watching. And whether you are celebrating Christmas or not, this weekend or whatever you're celebrating, if you're a Christian or whoever you are out there, I wish you guys a good, pleasant holiday. Hopefully, so you can spend time with your loved ones. And if you have good people in your life, people who love you unconditionally, people who accept you just as you are, if you have people who you can just be around and not have to feel that you're not good enough, you know, if you have good people around you and they make you feel better about yourself and all of that, and they don't cause you any problems or anything like that, please, you know, treasure them, be around them, and you know, make the most of it. I also pray that you guys, during this holiday, that you get the opportunity to get closer to God. I know I will try. So I pray for all of you, and I want to thank you all again for your support and the fact that you're even watching something this long. Thank you for that. So have a good night or day wherever you live, and I'll see you in the next video.